We were sitting there in quarantine trying to figure out, what will the fall be and having all of these unknowns. There was just a lot of what can't we do? Well, we know we can't do this and we can't do that. And I got really tired of that. And I thought, what can we do? One of the first things I thought of actually was Old Main the Thief. Because The Old Main the Thief, which was written in 1937, was written for the radio. And I'm like, we don't need a stage, we don't need a set, we don't need costumes, we don't need lights. I just need like a microphone, a singer, and a pianist, and actually four singers.
Rehearsing in a pandemic has been an interesting experience. All the singers have been masked for the whole process.
Suddenly, you have this piece of fabric like right in front of your face. And we're also rehearsing with plexiglass walls between us and at least 6 feet of distance. So it's definitely an adjustment to be farther away from your colleagues and also like diction and breathing. You kind of have to like put a filter of adjustment on.
She's a dichotomy. She is simultaneously a very prim and proper woman. She's like a leader in the community. And she also has like, she's a romantic to the extreme. And she very much, all she wants is to have a grand romance. It is a very fun and silly opera.
Yeah, it's set within a span of a week. And so much action happens between only four characters.
One of the important safety protocols is to make sure that you have the ability to leave the space and have the air be changed. COVID can be transmitted via air droplets or aerosols. So when you sing, you speak, and lots of things fly out of your mouth, and they are breathing deeply, deeper than most people, and they are expelling a lot more breath than most people. And so Worth Opera Studio, it's like a two-story ceiling that we've got in there. So there's a lot of air. The school was really quite good in researching how many cubic feet of air you had and how many people that would mean, and then how much time you could spend in the space before you would have to leave the space and let the air change out.
So Bob is a wanderer. He's someone who's never really had a stable life. And he comes to this town where nothing ever happens. And while he's there, it's the most exciting week this town has probably ever seen.
Like a lot of characters in the show, he is really a thinker and a dreamer. And while you see other characters talking about love and talking about real life and real events, he's mostly just dreaming.
Really just thinking about how we're producing it as an audio recording. This is a little harder because our staging has to be our imagination. We're really trying to see how we can make the opera vivid in its audio colors.
I think it's changing how I'm reflecting post-rehearsal. I'm listening for my character instead of listening for the beauty of my voice. I'm not listening to see, okay, yeah, that sounds right, this note's right. I'm listening to say, oh, does the word lonely sound lonely? Does the word quick sound quick? Or am I saying quick? I'm listening differently.
Letitia is, she's a smart cookie. She knows how to get what she wants, and she has a relationship with Miss Todd where she's able to manipulate her in ways. And she, at the same time, underneath all that, she's quite vulnerable and scared of becoming an old maid herself.
She doesn't want to be alone. She wants to experience love, even though I don't think that her idea of love is necessarily like a healthy, fully formed idea.
Opera singers, the goal is always to have the character come through in the voice, but it is easy to use the visual of the staging as a bit of a crutch in that regard. And this production really takes that crutch away. You don't have the ability to like make a face or do a gesture or do something physically to show what you're feeling. And so everything really has to come out in the sound and in the way you're breathing.
Miss Pinkerton is the town gossip. She wants to know everyone. She wants to know everything about everyone. And she wants everyone to know that she's the one who knows it. Because she's such a character role, has been very freeing for us both. We don't have to worry about sounding beautiful all the time. It's very much like, let's get the word across, let's make them laugh. It's been fun.
I would say as a radio production, one of the special things about that is having a narrator.
Letitia and Bob ransack the house and run toward the garage.
You just don't get that in other operas because you can see the action and you know the setting. So the narrator comes in to let you know who just ran up the stairs or what that sound was.
Music in a pandemic is important because it gives people something to rally around. And it's nice to have something to look forward to right now.
He neither seems pleased nor shocked.
I think we're very lucky to be at McGill. Everything was canceled, and Patrick and Stephen really brought us a lot of hope by bringing this project forward. And I think, like, I know I have a lot of family members and friends that are really looking forward to like experiencing this broadcast, this recording. And so it's like, it not only serves us, but it's something that we can share with other people in a time where like physically sharing things is really difficult.
After all of these months of Netflix and just having everything be visual, all of this visual stuff we're doing, watching on Zoom, how nice will it be to just listen?
The fact that it's only five people making music in a room at a time, and five people only making audio music, no visual component at a time, has made this process really artist-focused. There's nobody else, it's really just us, and us as a collaborative group of five, and then a second cast of five people. We take much more charge in our artistic decisions. We really are all together in this.
Everybody, welcome to a mini cast party for the Old Maid and the Thief listening party that we're getting ready to launch into. But first, we wanted you to meet the faces of the cast and also our music director, pianist, who were responsible for putting this recording together. So before we start, let's introduce each other. I'm Patrick Hansen. I'm the director of opera studies for Opera McGill at the Schulich School of Music at McGill University.
I'm Lindsay Gable. I played Miss Todd, and I'm in my graduate diploma at McGill.
I am Avery LaFrance, and I was playing Miss Pinkerton. I am finishing my master's here at McGill.
I'm Raphael Leguin-Gandon. I played Bob, and I'm also finishing my master's at McGill.
I'm Jess Tupin. I played the role of Letitia, and I am also finishing my master's at McGill.
My name is Marie Lavandier. I was the voice of the narrator, and I'm in my fourth year undergrad.
And I'm Stephen Hargraves, the pianist and music director of this production.
Thank you all for being here. Really excited to hear your cast recording very soon. But before we get to that, we wanted to talk a little bit about kind of how we did this. Maybe we'll start with Stephen, if you want to talk us through the process a little bit. And then after that, if anybody has any, you know, insights or stories or, you know, other ideas about the process, just chime in. Stephen.
So, I think it might be helpful to just talk about our normal process. Our normal process with something like this would be I'm coaching a lot, and so I'll be kind of calling coachings to all the singers early in the process, and pretty early on we would be getting both casts together in a room, and they hear each other, and so I might be rehearsing with a duo, and then the duo from the other cast is hearing that information being conveyed. Because of COVID, we weren't able to have the casts in the same room. So for the most part, I was coaching in person, masked, but individuals. And that was for the first, you know, number of weeks. And then, you know, gradually adding one person at a time from the same cast, you know, to do duos and trios, and but it did lead to a quite, you know, unique version for each cast. Usually the casts, that they learn a lot from each other, but in this case the cast developed on their own and created their own unique personalities and unique approaches, which I think you'll hear if you hear both cast recordings.
Yeah, what was that like for you guys?
I definitely think it was strange. I'm used to seeing my friends, my peers, play similar roles to me and kind of take from them, be inspired from them, and then the reciprocal as well. But I think there was actually great freedom in not knowing what somebody else was doing with the exact role. Like, I felt a lot of artistic freedom to just create her, because it's almost as if like our cast was in a literal COVID bubble, but also like an artistic bubble of like, we create, and if we're satisfied with it, then we keep moving. Cause it was really just the five of us in a room. And Patrick joined us once over like Source Connect, I think. Yes. And that was really funny too, because we're used to also not just having our peers, but a full panel of, you know, administrators, directors, music, like conductors, you have all of these people. So to just kind of have each other, it's very freeing in a way, I think.
Yeah, there's a lot of trust there, you know? I had to trust Stephen to like make musical decisions with singers. Oh my goodness. I think what's going to be really exciting actually is the different decisions that are made between the casts, right? But you still have the same pianist. So I think that will also be kind of a testament to kind of our process here, which is to try to help people, you know, develop their own artistry and their own artistic choices. Any other thoughts on that before I ask another question?
Let me just contribute one thing. Yeah. What I found interesting actually is the particular challenge of recording versus performing on stage, that there was just such I found it ultimately freeing to kind of be dealing just with the sound of people's voices. But it also is kind of at some level, singers know, like many singers know how to act and know how to act quite well, but as a whole, but to use just their voice to convey things is really quite an interesting challenge. I personally feel like, oh, we should be doing this, you know, as a pedagogical tool all the time.
Absolutely. So what was that like to record, you know, like the microphone is there, it's staring at you. What was that, daunting? Were you pulling your hair out? Were you like paranoid? Like, what was that like?
I thought it was really cool and brought me into the process in a different way. I was kind of like, you know, the way the microphone works is it captures different colors. So when you're whispering, it's actually more effective to get closer to the mic than it is to go farther away so that you sound further away. Is this working in real time? I don't know. But it was it was really fun to experiment with that. And I also found that I was listening in different ways when I would listen back. You know, we all record a little bit to just see what's going on, because especially in this process where we didn't have as much or as many people to be saying, okay, this sounds like this, this needs this. I found it was a much more acoustic analysis, and I feel like I'm going to bring that forward into characters that are, you can see, because it's like, I kind of felt low-key, like a Disney princess in the recording booth, and I was like, I need to make everything sound magical. So, that's where I'm at on that.
Lindsay, you've done a lot of roles with Opera McGill. How is this different?
This is very different in a lot of ways. There was a lot less direct feedback, I think, in this process than there is in other processes, which really made it imperative that we take charge of our own artistry and make decisions. And I think that that's been really beneficial for me in a lot of ways. I think about my voice in a very different way than I did before I worked on this production. I'm very much thinking about not just like the general things you think about in a production are not just the voice, but also your gestures and how you're moving on stage and how you're interacting with everybody. This process really let us focus on more on our own individual performances and how they were going with the ensemble, and which was a very interesting experience for me. And I felt like I was able to do a lot of really detailed work in this, which was very fun.
Raphael, you've been silent, much like Bob.
Well, I think that so in a normal production, in a normal stage production, I'd find the process to be one of, you know, starting focused on yourself, you know, your music has to be learned, you're learning your blocking, and then there's this gradual sort of opening up that happens, and then as you get more and more comfortable, you're engaging with your other cast members more, you're really, you know, taking it all in at once. And with this, it was very much the opposite. I think we were very, at first, engaging with each other and looking around and making those connections, and then as this recording week went on, we got more and more focused on the mic and turned inwards from, you know, so the other way around than you might see in a normal stage production.
That's so interesting. You know, Marie had a very different process than everybody else. Well, I was there for her recording sessions via Zoom, but she was there all alone in her sound booth with the microphone. And Marie, why don't you tell us about that? What was this like for you?
So the recording session itself was something I had never experienced before. I was kind of nervous going in too, but it was just like me alone, and I would get feedback on like how to do the line. We'd take multiple takes of like each narration thing. And it would just be like, okay, but pretend you're from the 1930s and you're just like, ladies and gentlemen, like it was just like, I could do whatever I wanted and I could take so many different choices. And I feel like every single take I took was, you know, completely different. They had a lot of choices in that one. And then other than that, as the narrator, first of all, you don't get that in opera. Like I've never been asked to do that before. And I also wasn't in contact with the rest of the cast except for the like production meetings at the start of the semester. So I got like an idea of where this was going. We read through the libretto. And then I was just kind of left alone to like go over the show and like the written narration lines. And then most of the work was that recording session. So it was really fun.
Yeah, some of the challenges of the narration is that we're trying to get part of the, like, the stage directions, you know, Letitia runs upstairs, but sometimes there's like, you know, like, no this space. Much time to do it. So I was like, Marie, faster. She's like, Letitia runs upstairs. I'm like, faster. And she's like, Letitia runs upstairs. We're like, okay, not that fast. So that was kind of a fun thing. I mean, it was hundreds of takes because there were lots of, it's the narration. You'll hear it when you listen to the opera. It's not just before each scene. There's also some narration in the middle of the scenes. And that indeed will be probably the thing that connects the two different recordings, is that the takes that we're choosing for Marie will most likely be the same takes for each of those recordings. So that'll be kind of interesting to see if it feels different somehow. And of course, the person who had to play this score 6,000 kazillion times, Stephen Hargreaves, what was that like, Mr. Hargreaves?
You know, it was a lot of fun, actually. My forearms were very tired at the end of Saturday, at the end of the week of recording. And it's because there are a lot of just like that, 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 that. And so you have to kind of like bounce your wrist. And I had to do it for just hours on end, 20 or so. Complete runs of the opera. That just is, it's a lot. But it's so inspiring to me to be working with, young artists who are just kind of like exploring things. And it was just a lot of fun, I have to say.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to hearing that. So I particularly the overture, and also there's a section of this opera that's written in three staves, which is kind of written for three hands. So I'll be very interested to see how that was all accomplished.
Me too.
Before we end and this sort of talk, what's next for everybody? What are you looking forward to? What's your next project that's happening? Lindsay, why don't you start off?
My next project is Mrs. Groves in The Turn of the Screw by Benjamin Britten, which we'll be doing in January, which is then followed by Much Ado, a workshop of Patrick's libretto and James Garner's score. I will also be doing The Crucible at Opera Nuova this summer.
Lots of fun on that one.
I'm going to be in the Turn of the Screw project as well as the governess. Stephen and I started a run through last week. We did act one and it was absolutely perfect. We were ready to go on stage.
Good. Excellent. So no more coachings for you. You're good to go. Speaking of the Turn of the Screw.
I will also be joining these fabulous ladies as one of the Miss Jessels. So I'm really looking forward to that. And then also I will have the Met Council Opera Regional District auditions in January. And that'll be my first live Zoom audition. So looking forward to what that might be like.
Yeah, they've been doing a number of those already on districts and so that's going to be exciting. Raphael.
I will be singing the role of Ophémon in L'Amant Anonyme, which is an opera by Joseph Boulogne. Really excited to dive into that score, which has been reconstructed by Stephen. So that'll be a really fun project. Wonderful.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that as well. Marie, you've been busy actually this semester because you were doing something else.
I was working simultaneously on the digital opera projects. So I was singing the role of Emily in The Yellow Wallpaper. So these were digital opera projects that were filmed in Pollock and they were done with Tapestry Opera's Michael Morey, which was really fun. So you'll hear that next week after this broadcasts.
And finally, Stephen, I think you're taking a vacation next semester? Do you have anything to do?
Yeah, I'm only doing things that I want to do. So, I'm conducting Turn of the Screw, one of my absolute favorite pieces. I'll be involved playing for the Much Ado workshop. And that is super exciting. I can't wait to sort of see how Act One is kind of shaping up. And then I'm also, I've been very hard at work at creating an edition for the L'Amant Anonyme, which will be a Canadian premiere. And it's a great piece. It's really exciting. So, and then I'll be just be, you know, around basically at as many rehearsals as I can be at, we'll sort of see.
Yeah.
So very exciting.
Yeah, all of these projects are happening in the winter semester. In addition to this, we start with The Turn of the Screw, which will be webcast on January 30th and January 31st from Polycall with members of the McGill Symphony Orchestra. Really excited about that. And then we follow that up with a workshop of a new opera by Luna Pearl-Wolf and Andrea Stolowitz, called The Limit of the Sun. That'll be early in February. And then later in February, Rodgers and Hammerstein's Cinderella, which is, I believe, the first Rodgers and Hammerstein opera musical that Opera McGill has done in its 60 plus years. So that's really exciting. And then we turn in late February to staging Partenope by Handel. And in early March, staging the L'Amant Anonyme. And then in the same week, in weekend, we are performing both Handel's Partenope and Bologne's L'Amant Anonyme in Pollock, both of them with orchestra, with the Baroque Orchestra, McGill Baroque Orchestra, and then also members of the McGill Symphony Orchestra for the Bologne. And then right after that, Un Giorno di Regno, which will be accompanied by piano and directed by one of our students who's getting her graduate diploma in performance, Soyo Craig. And it's a big semester. We're also at the same time at the end of March and early April workshopping three wonderful new one acts by with Musique Trois Femmes by female composers and librettist teams. And we're really looking forward to that. Plus a workshop of Much Ado by James Garner and Shakespeare, and sort of by me. So that's what we're doing. It's, a couple days of rehearsal on all of those, and you know, we'll all be fine, no stress. But it's really exciting, the support that we've been feeling from McGill University and Schulich School of Music during this pandemic, to be able to continue to bring content. And we hope all of you out there listening to The Old Maid and the Thief, come back. In the end of November, we'll have a watch party for our digital opera projects. Don't miss that. And then, of course, next semester, you'll get to see all of these people in various and different ways through the semester. So thank you, everyone. And it's time to enjoy Giancarlo Menotti's The Old Maid and the Thief.
Opera McGill and the Schulich School of Music present Giancarlo Menotti's The Old Maid and the Thief, described by the composer, who was also the librettist, as a grotesque opera in 14 scenes. The Old Maid and the Thief was originally conceived as a radio opera and broadcast by the National Broadcasting Company on April 22, 1939. This recording was created by Samuel Hanna, Mie Hirschfield, and Antoine Gallois under the supervision of Martha DeFrancisco on November 5th, 6th, and 7th of 2020 in Tana Hall in the Elizabeth Wirth Music Building on the campus of McGill University in Montreal, Quebec. I am Marie Lavandier, your narrator for this recording. Our student cast is Lindsay Gable as Miss Todd, Jessica Tupin as Letitia, her maid, Raphael Leyden-Gadon as Bob, a wanderer, and Avery LaFrance as Miss Pinkerton, the town gossip. The action takes place in a small town, somewhere in the United States, in the late 1930s. And now, we welcome Stephen Hargreaves, our pianist, to the stage to begin the overture. late afternoon in Miss Todd's parlor. Miss Pinkerton is just arriving for a visit.
Thank you. Letitia!
Letitia runs down from upstairs.
Yes, ma'am!
Somebody knocked at the back door.
I will go and see.
Letitia runs to the kitchen.
Who can it be?
Letitia runs back to the parlor.
Well then, who is it?
It is a man!
A man!
What does he want?
She signals to Miss Todd to get rid of Miss Pinkerton.
He says that he must speak to you in strict privacy.
The idea!
Don't you see? I am having tea with Miss Pinkerton. Tell him to come back later, not on my account. It's time for me to go home anyhow. So soon? It was such a short afternoon. Goodbye then, Miss Pinkerton. Goodbye, Miss Todd. Your mantlet, your overshoes. Come soon again. I thank you. Goodbye. This way. Well, ask the visitor to come in.
Ma'am, he's not a visitor. He's only a beggar.
A beggar? Give him a nickel and send him away.
But he's so young and handsome. Don't send him away. It would be a sin.
What shall I do then?
Be a Christian. Ask him if.
What will the neighbors say?
Who cares? Just take a look at him.
They both go to the kitchen and open the door.
Come in, good man.
Thank you.
Letitia, run upstairs and
if it is so.
Bob stretches in front of the fire.
I'll have some.
What a beautiful torso.
The next morning, Letitia is busy with her pots and pans when Miss Todd comes into the kitchen, dressed in her kimono. Bob's breakfast is ready, and Letitia proudly carries the heaping tray to the guest room, where Bob lies drowsily in bed.
Good morning! Hey! Good morning, Bob!
Oh. Look out. No. No.
Wake up!
Run away! They're coming!
Wake up!
Who is it?
Wake up! It's I!
No.
I miss mistress is distressed.
And why?
Because you're going away. And she gave me the task to ask if you would stay with us another week.
Stay here another week?
Yes.
To eat and drink and sleep without paying food nor rent.
Yes.
God bless you, that's cheap.
Well then, do you consent?
How could anyone refuse?
But what of your ideal?
An ideal to the ideal must suffer treason. Even ideals listen to reason.
Then it is settled.
With your permission.
But for the neighbors, your cousin Steve, and we believe it shall be wise to shun suspicion, that you be seen by no one.
It shall be done, but I warn you both before, I'm your cousin, nothing more. I hate women to the core.
Do you mean you'll never marry, even when they're young and shy, and can cook as well?
I'll admit you're very, very...
Oh, the stupid boar! So I'm very, very... coming! What was it we were saying?
I'll say it another day.
Letitia goes downstairs while Miss Todd walks out into the street. A few minutes later, Miss Todd ventures out of the house to do some marketing. Down the block, whom does she see approach but her friend, Miss Pinkerton?
Miss Todd! Miss Todd! Oh, Miss Pinkerton, good morning. Have you heard? Have you heard? A most terrible thief has fled from the curtain.
From her newspaper.
Tall and burly, hair black and curly, light complexion, southern inflection, and altogether handsome. Oh.
Miss Todd snatches the newspaper from Miss Pinkerton.
Tall and burly.
Going away, I believe, this very morning.
Pinkerton disappears around the corner, while Miss Todd hurries back to the house. Miss Todd can't hurry home quickly enough, for the similarity of Bob's appearance and the description Miss Pinkerton gave of the escaped criminal has given her plenty of cause for alarm. Into the front door she flies, and into the parlor, where Letitia is dusting.
Did not rob and murder us last night. to find the money.
I to the treasurer of the New Mission Society and of the Women's Club.
Lord Almighty, do you suggest that I should steal?
Pass by. Bob remains a guest in Miss Todd's house. A week later, we find Letitia in the kitchen, taking pains mending and then pressing a pair of well-worn trousers. Bob's, of course.
Oh!
A little later in the day, Miss Todd is sitting in her parlor when Miss Pinkerton rushes in, breathless with excitement.
Miss Todd! Miss Todd!
Miss Pinkerton, won't you sit down?
Have you heard? Have you read? The thief is to hide in a town and has robbed many houses in that neighborhood. He's daring, quick, and shrewd. You're not safe even under your roof. Keep all the doors locked. Keep all the windows gone.
But has someone heard any proof?
Miss Manning has missed lots of money.
Oh.
Miss Bagson has not seen her purse since that morning you came for a visit.
There is no more doubt, the robber must be hereabout.
And since our church meeting on Monday, the Sunday collection is missing. We must ask the police for protection. We must!
Suddenly, in complete silence, Letitia crosses the room, proudly carrying over her arms Bob's freshly pressed trousers. Miss Pinkerton stares, open-mouthed, while Letitia mounts the stairs and hands the trousers to Bob through the bedroom door, opened to a crack.
Isn't the weather awful? Awful! Awful! But, by the way, how is your cousin? Is he still so very, very ill? I'm afraid that he never will be.
A few days go by. Miss Todd is sitting in her parlor. Letitia is in the kitchen, getting ready to go upstairs with a customary morning tray, so that Bob can have his breakfast in bed as usual. Meanwhile, Bob, up in his room, prompted by a desire to take to the road again, is secretly making a bundle of his clothes.
Wander in youth and joy, then you'll wander.
Letitia is seen going upstairs with a tea tray. Has dropped her tray.
What are you packing for?
I'm going away.
Why? What is wrong?
I belong to the road. Being shut in a house all day long makes me restless, nervous, and weak.
Yes, dear Bob, don't go away. If you stay another week, I'll give you the money.
This is not what I Here I have nothing to do. From morning till night, I don't read, I don't write, I don't work, I don't think. If at least I could have...
What?
Well, just something to drink.
My dear, do you mean liquor?
Letitia runs downstairs.
Miss Todd! Miss Todd! Don't shout that way! Bob threatens to go away if we don't buy him liquor!
Liquor!
Has he no pity? I who direct the Prohibition Committee. I who founded the anti-booze. No, no! I must refuse! Has he no pity? Already I've stolen for him, and now he demands that I smile like I'm standing. I'm publicly buying some liquor. I must refuse, I must refuse, I must refuse, I must refuse. Stealing a sin!
o'clock in the morning. The village is sleeping quietly. In front of the liquor store, all is deserted, except for a policeman on his rounds. As soon as he disappears down the block, two stealthy figures are seen approaching. It is Miss Todd and Letitia, carrying flashlights. They try to force a window.
The lock is tight. Let me try it. Push. 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 Oh! Let us crawl in.
The next morning, Miss Todd is in her parlor, knitting, when the door bursts open.
Miss Todd! Miss Todd! Miss Pinkerton, won't you sit down? Have you heard? Have you heard? The whole town is in an uproar for last night. Someone ran in the liquor store. The owner roused out of bed. Corner in town. No, they will turn every house upside down.
Miss Pinkerton is ushered out the door. Miss Todd, hurry, Letitia. There is no time to lose. Out of the parlor, up the stairs to Bob's room. But they find the door closed.
Knock at the door.
Come, if not for Joe,
for
but what have you done?
To get you some money, we robbed almost everyone.
Miss Paxton,
Miss Channing,
Miss Jackson,
Miss Manny,
and raided a store.
You raided a store?
We raided a store. But now that you worry, I won't let you down. I'll stand by to defend you.
She's crazy.
Of course we must act in a hurry.
She's
crazy. And kids that we've made.
She's crazy.
We'll run off together to France and lead a new life of adventure and crime and romance.
She's crazy.
She's crazy.
You'll be my escort. I'm your financial and moral support.
But why should I? Have I?
So, is your love for me so small you won't stand by?
Small? I don't love you at all.
Ungrateful wretch. After all that I have done for you, to see me in prison.
As a matter of fact, I don't see any reason for keeping you out of it.
I can make you feel sorry for this. I shall call the police. I shall accuse you of larceny.
Is there any justice?
Justice like every other
Ladies and gentlemen, is the final scene.
Latisha!
holding an empty liquor bottle Bob left behind. Miss Pinkerton pokes her head in the front door. She views the scene with triumphant indignation. This is Marie Lavandier, thanking you for joining us for this broadcast of Menotti's The Old Maid and the Thief.